Assalamu alaikum. Mr. Moderator, our distinguished guests, brothers and sisters, our friends and our enemies.
Absolutely, and I'd say jazakallah khair, Abwal, really for unpacking it. And I think
as we
draw to a conclusion, I think Abdurrahim and I would say you're coming back for part two.
You don't want me to come back, I'm telling you.
Broadcasts
tend to be a bit more interactive, although like the fact that me and Abdulhaq said nothing just shows how fascinated we were. MashaAllah, we really enjoyed it, inshallah, alhamdulillah. Bro, we're going to have to get you back on again because there's so much more that we want to talk about, to be honest.
Can I just say something, which I've been meaning to say to you both, and there's one or two others that I would like to say for maybe 12, 15 years now. Actually, the dawah that you were doing, grassroots, Abdurrahim was much more of an international traveler than yourself or myself, but you were also doing grassroots, just primarily in Brixton, just bringing people from Iman to Kufr and strengthening Iman.
I hope not.
SubhanAllah.
I know you,
from Kufr to Iman and strengthening their love for Islam.
Yeah.
That probably has more kind of serious hasanat with our Lord than some of the details that were only going to apply to about 10 people in this whole world, someone like I was dealing with. And that probably still applies even today. So actually, even though this is fascinating and I'm glad you're interested and some foundations probably need to be revised and thought of, actually, alhamdulillah, Allah's blessed you in ways that perhaps you realize or you don't. May Allah bless you. There are people that I meet that, you know, just say, you know, I love God, I love Allah, I love the Sunnah of the Prophet, and it goes back to very often Abdurrahim, but also yourself, and one or two other people, including Abu Sufyan. I couldn't imagine there being, you know, more than like three people on this earth who would say that about Abu Ali. They might say some nice
things. Listen, I'll tell you something, bro. There's a lot more people than you think. And just because your name is not there, it doesn't mean that those articles you wrote, that Al Hidayah magazine, bro, that you, subhanAllah, literally published by the impact of that. Al-Iman, bro, and Istiqama, wasn't it? I've still got them somewhere. The articles, listen, and how many of my talks and Abdulhaq's talks and lectures and khutbahs were taken from those articles? So, bro, don't underestimate your contribution and, you know, don't over-humble your eye. What you said about yourself is not true either, because you were not dealing with stuff that was only concerning 10 people, bro, right? You know, a lot of the stuff that you, and also, bro, one of the issues, one of the things that you've always talked about, I mean, I know you and me had lots of discussions about this, because like we had some of our roots and some Sufism from the early days, both of our Islam. So we were always very, very interested in the whole spiritual dimension. You never gave up. I think neither of us ever gave up that sort of element of our dawah as well. All of that is very impactful, bro. So seriously, you know, like, I think you're underestimating your contribution, bro. Even if I would say that the impact that you personally had and the contribution you've made to my growth and knowledge and insights and understandings and huge conversation. Oh, bro, how many hours we spent talking about stuff? So it's all been very beneficial, bro. And sometimes that's it, you know, you have a person and someone else is their translator, you know, they just take what they say and they condense it. And that's what I love doing. What I like doing is taking complicated stuff and making it simple for people. Honestly, that's what I love doing, you know. So
And that's
how many gems and how many things and how many benefits I got from you, because I never until now got access to that Arabic.
With yourself as well, you know the level and degree of engagement. I'm referring to things, as you heard, that you maybe forgot about from the mid to early late 90s. On things that I've brought them up in the beginning of this podcast. So yeah, don't underestimate yourself. What I would say, this has been fascinating. I think there does need to be a part two. The reason Abdurrahim and I were excited to be bringing you on board is because that, you know, Abdurrahim and myself, we've used to spend hours traveling in cars and sitting in these hours having breakfast. There's a convergence in what we're saying. And I think that there's a maturation that's taken place, certainly amongst us speaking now, with regards to understanding a wider context of Salafism, and what it means, and where it's gone, and where it's morphed, and everything like that. I still feel that there needs to be some sort of ownership, because we are in really perilous times now, where we've got liberal extremism amongst the Muslims, we've got esoterism that's going to an extent where people are committing shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've got a behavioral, as I call it, extremism from within. And those who are coming into Islam, which Abdurrahim, he was talking a week or so ago, which was right what he was saying, that it's just about calling to the dawah. We need to call to Islam. It's the simplicity of that. And Abdurrahim has always stuck with that point, and I agree with that as well. But that simplicity, which is required, has got so many obstacles around it now, that when individuals are coming in and embracing Islam, their head's almost been turned 360 degrees. But what shouldn't happen is what we're seeing amongst particular Salafi cults, if it were, that you come into Islam and you're taught to hate immediately everyone and everything that's outside of that clique. And as you said, Ibn Taymiyyah, Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, likened it to the Khawarij in that splitting of subsidiary matters. So I feel that the Muslim identity, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying we must bang that drum or wear that badge of Salafia. That's what, when I say that, when that's happening, that's what I'm talking about, the bastardization, the Salafi uniform, and this particular restriction that's been placed on it by those who think that they're claiming and owning it, but in actuality, they're stifling the heartbeat of what it actually represents, mashallah, which is Islam. And that story that Abdurrahim and I know, and you know, when we were taught about the likening given of a stream of a group, a community that's settled by this pure stream, and they were taking and getting all their strength and their fresh water from that stream. But then the next generation started throwing pollutants into that stream, and basically they started becoming sick because they were drinking from it and throwing pollutants in. The enemy then came, conquered them, took possession of their land and everything, and then three groups emerged from that original community. The first one saying, we need to build hospitals so that we can become well again. But others said, but then we're still going to be taken from the stream and it's polluted. The second group said, no, until we've conquered our enemies and we fought our enemies, we won't get our victory and our honor back again. We know those first two groups are. The third group said, no, both of you, these things cannot happen until we have purified the stream. And the stream, and then the third group were the group who we would like to the Salafis, who were saying, you need to purify the stream being Islam, the stream being Tawheed. And that similitude we are seeing played out today. So who are those today who are going to be saying, we need to purify the Aqidah, we need to purify the Sunnah, we need to do that? Not in the way that we're seeing it being done by some elements today, but it still needs to be done.
We respect them, but we want them to respect us. We think that the law should respect the Negro community. The law should protect the Negro community. the law should approach the Negro community with intelligence if it expects the Negro community to react intelligently.